The fiscal cliff. Fiscal Norm, fiscal Bob, why is he fiscal cliff? I don't know. And why don't we just run right off of it? Robert Berry is a publisher, does several books, and also you do usamens.com, which is a great website that you ought to look at. We all have got this idea what this fiscal cliff is, that if the House and the President don't make some deal by the end of the year, then automatic cuts go into effect for entitlements and defense and all sorts of other things, and taxes go roaring back up for all tax breaks. I just have this most simple question. Why is it so bad if we go over the cliff?
Yeah, you know, I'm one of those people, and I think more people are thinking this way. Maybe this isn't such a bad thing. You know, there's a price to be paid when you lose an election. It's not a good thing when the Republicans lost this election. There was going to be they're going to have to take their lumps, and these are the lumps.
Why is it a lump? I'm missing that part.
Well, you know, this in a sense, it's not, because you're right. We should be paying our bills.
And because, you know, Obama won, and everybody said, Obama won. Yeah, right. He did. But also, every House member was up for retention re-election or new, and the House members also won. So we've got a split here.
Well, you got divided government, and this is kind of what the American people tell us they want. You know, gridlock is not such a bad thing. Everybody thinks it's a terrible thing. You know, this whole idea of a fiscal cliff is a media creation. Do you remember what we called it before we had the term fiscal cliff?
No.
It was being called Taxmageddon.
Right?
And I guess that wasn't catchy enough. So they came up with this idea of let's the fiscal cliff. That's it. That's what we'll call it. It's the fiscal cliff, and we're going to go over it. And this whole idea, what they're doing, the media is very good at this. They're ginning up a tremendous amount of anxiety. And the effect of that is to put pressure on the Republicans to make a deal, any kind of a deal, just so they can say they dealt with the problem. Okay? And in Washington, that's kind of the idea. Because if you make a deal in Washington,
you pass it on to the next.
Well, this is the idea. Because if you do nothing and something bad happens, they can say, "Well, you're a do-nothing Congress, and this terrible thing that happened is your fault." But when they do something, anything, then they can say, "If it works, if things improve, they can say, well, you know, it's a really good thing we did that. We solved the problem. We cured the
problem." But do they solve the problem?
But
from what I understand, they don't. Let me give you my take on this.
Okay.
The bad part of the Bush-era tax cuts was that they took a progressive tax system where we punished the more productive people and the employers more than lower income folks, and then made it more progressive. That is, yeah, rich people got a tax cut, but working families and lower income folks got a much bigger tax cut.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Now what's going to happen is only rich people, those people who create jobs, those people are going to pay more in taxes, but the others are going to stay down low. So we took a progressive tax system, we made it more progressive, and after this deal, and I'm certain it's going to happen, we're going to have even a more progressive tax system where the wealthy are ostracized, and it's not going to make a damn bit of difference when it comes to the big problems of entitlement spending.
And that's the thing about it, because what you're talking about is really the mother of all half measures when it comes to how much of an improvement this is going to make in fiscal matters. It doesn't really amount to a hill of beans, but it does matter enough to where it is going to hurt the economy. And what I get a kick out of is that 2 years ago, when Obama extended these cuts, it was in effect to prevent this from crippling the recovering economy. Now we have an economy that is every bit as much in jeopardy of going back into recession again, at least officially. I believe that we're already in recession, possibly even worse. But all of a sudden, that same argument that they made 2 years ago has gone by the boards. They're not making that argument anymore. And I think I know why. I think the reason is because they don't care.
What do you mean?
I don't think that he's got his reelection. He's in there. He's in there for the next 4 years. Where they're coming at from this thing, I am absolutely convinced, is they think this is payback time. This country needs to be taken down a notch or two. I think they're perfectly comfortable with this. I don't think that the Obama
You're talking the administration.
I'm talking about the Obama administration.
Let's talk about the Republicans for a second. Mm-hmm. Now, you've heard of Caldera's political axiom, number one. There is nothing Republicans can't screw up. I use a little different language, but you've got the point.
Yes, exactly.
There is no question in my mind that the Republicans are going to bend on this.
Yeah.
That one way or another, they're going to tax the wealthy more. Yeah. You know, they want to do it by closing loopholes. Great, I'm all for it. Go ahead and do that. But sooner or later, there will be a rate increase. And what it really does is it protects them from having to make the real tough decisions on spending.
Oh, yeah.
You know, if we go over this cliff, automatic cuts to defense, automatic cuts in entitlements, and still were in trouble even after going over.
Well, that's the thing. You know, as I said, this is the mother of all half measures, because what they're cutting here is the rate of increase. So they're not really cutting any spending. Even in defense, if I got my math right, they're still going to be spending more next year than they did this year. So it really doesn't do anything. The Republicans' objective in this little negotiation is to kick the can. That is what they want to do. That is all they want to do. They want to kick the can and live to fight again another day. And if that means capitulating, they will capitulate. And we've seen this in recent history. Boehner has caved in at least three major negotiations. And my biggest fear is...
What are those three?
Well, it was the original... In 2011, when the Republicans came in January, they had... Right away, they faced the budget negotiation.
Right.
Okay? So remember that the Obama stimulus that had been in the year before... So it was a $787 billion. Because of baseline budgeting, that ended up automatically being imputed into the next year's budget. The best, instead of the Republicans going after the entirety of that, they tried to get $100 billion of that back, okay? Within a day or two, they caved, and that went down to 51, then 32, and then zero. And by the time it was all done, they didn't get any cuts.
So what I don't understand is that nobody likes Congress. Congress's approval ratings hover around 10%.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter if they do a spectacular job or if they do a lousy job. We're going to hate their guts.
Mm-hmm.
From my point of view, this is a perfect opportunity to do the right thing. At some point, we need to pay our bills.
Right.
At some point, we need to control spending. This intergenerational theft of how we are raping the future and our kids' future just so we can have more toys and entitlements today is so morally corrupt.
Yeah.
It seems like now is a good time to take a stand because it's only going to get worse.
Is my math wrong on this? Your math is wrong, but let me tell you something.
It is wrong or it isn't?
It's you're right on the money.
Okay.
I totally agree with you. But here's the other thing we got to factor into this, is that Boehner in particular, he's a lead negotiator on this thing, okay? He has caved every single time. He caved after the first budget deal, he caved when they did the debt ceiling, okay? Then he caved again when it came to the present, when they wanted to raise, kick the can on the end of the Bush era tax cuts, okay? So that's where we are right now. So that's three in a row. This guy's 0-for-3. Okay? And it's really amazing how somebody like him, and I spent a lot of time looking at him, I wrote a lot about him, and I looked at this guy's psyche, and it's the most amazing thing I've ever seen, because do you know how ruthless you have to be to become the head of your conference? To get to be the Speaker of the House in your conference, you've got to be a pretty tough guy, okay? So what amazes me is how do you get to that position? And then when it comes to locking horns with the opposition, you cave every single time. It's just like one capitulation after another. So my biggest fear is that this guy is, they're going to get this guy in a room, and Washington, what they say is, the term for this is, we can roll this guy, okay?
Right.
So they're going to get him in the room, and they're going to roll him. And by the time the thing is all over, they're going to hand him his head, and he's going to walk out of there with the worst deal you've ever seen in your life, and he's going to think it was his idea. And that's what my big concern is.
Why would Republicans want a deal? Now, I get if they could keep things the way they are, if they could keep the tax structure the way it is without making it even more progressive, without punishing success, because that's what we're doing with a progressive tax system, we punish success. When we do that, if Republicans have to make a choice, do we either make a deal where we punish success, or do we see every income bracket jump up? I mean, right now we have half the population pays no income tax whatsoever.
Yeah.
We have the classic free rider problem that there is no income tax being paid by half of the population. All we want to do, I'm an anti-tax guy. This has been my career. But are we at the point now where if we're going to do this, don't throw away this one part on one group who is successful. Let's do it on everybody and get back to where we were in the Clinton years.
Right. Well, we are going to get one part of that's for sure is that when this thing comes in at midnight at the end of this year, we are going to have the Clinton rates back again.
No, we're not. I will put down my $5 that Republicans cave.
Oh, you're saying we might end up with worse than that?
No, we're going to.
Because I don't agree with that.
No, on the lower levels, they're going to stay the same. Obama's going to become victorious on this. Republicans are going to lose, and there will be tax increases for people who make more money.
You know, there's another way to accomplish that. If Obama does nothing and lets this thing and doesn't push hard for the end of the year, then that will happen automatically. And then all he needs to do is, when the new Congress comes in on the 3rd of January, all he needs to do is go back and say, look, we've already got the rates that we wanted. So now what we're going to do is we're going to offer everybody else except for the rich a tax cut. And the Republicans will have to take that. So you're going to end up with that nightmare scenario. But that's only for a couple months, because then we got, I guess what's coming up in March, is we got the next debt ceiling fight. So that's when Boehner's going to go back in for the next round of negotiation, where he's going to get his hand ahead into him again. Yeah. This is exactly the situation you get into when you have a lousy negotiator.
It's amazing how Republicans just suck at this.
They're terrible.
We are terrible. When George the First was president, what was a rallying cry? It's the economy, stupid.
Yeah.
Now that doesn't work now. It's not the economy. But why aren't we saying it's the spending, stupid? I'm both under George W. and under this guy who took it to warp levels.
Yeah.
This is not just unsustainable, it's what?
Well, the term I like to use is it's not unsustainable, it's insurmountable. That is the difference. Is if I went home today and I got a $40 million bill in my mailbox, I wouldn't be saying, you know, gee, I really need to cut down the eating
cable.
Out so much.
Yeah,
you know,
I
need to turn the cable off. I'd say, look, this is an insurmountable debt. I can't pay it. And ultimately, we're going to have to come to grips with this thing. And that's why I say that's the real fiscal cliff. Because right now, this thing is going to be, compared to what I think we're in for, this is going to be a non-event. The real event is when the Fed loses control of interest rates, that's when you're going to see the real fiscal cliff.
All right, just less than a minute. If you had a magic wand and have Congress pass anything, what would it be?
Balanced budget immediately right now, and they can have this if the Republicans would stick to their guns, and the next time a debt ceiling vote comes up, they hold the line and they say, we have an instant balanced budget right now, end of story. They control the most important part of Congress, which is the House of Representatives, where all spending bills must originate. They have the best, really, lock in town.
People want to get more information, where do they go?
USAmends.com, or simply do a search on Google for Amendments Without Congress.
Amendments Without Congress. Bob, thank you so much. Hey, listen for me on KHOW Radio, particularly on Sunday afternoons. Tell a friend about the Independence Institute. Check us out at independenceinstitute.org, and we'll see you next week.